You know, when something hard comes our way, I was talking to someone recently who's having a really tough time in their context at this period in time. And the tendency that happens is that tough time just fills our horizon. We just end up thinking all the time about the difficulties, about the problems, about who said what, and how are we going to deal with this, and what's going to happen next, and it just fills the horizon. When we do that, we are actually moving out of God's best for us. We need to continue to allow our minds, our horizon, to be filled by Jesus. And recognize that these are normal things that happen on the route. And the amazing thing is that God always, how often?
Always.
Uses those things for our good.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called When Jesus Comes, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13 to 3, verse 5, by Pastor David Wise.
A few weeks ago, we started a new series looking at 1 Thessalonians, and I've commented on each time that 1 Thessalonians was probably the very first part of the New Testament to be written, probably written less than 20 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. The context was that Paul, with Timothy and Silas, had visited Thessalonica to tell them about Jesus, to preach the gospel, and as a result of that, a new church was born. However, there was major opposition to Paul, so he had to leave prematurely. When he was unable to return, he sent Timothy to visit the young church community that consisted solely of new converts. And this letter was written in response to the news that Paul received from Timothy. Now, I gave you some homework last time, and I asked you to make sure that before I came back and spoke on 1 Thessalonians again, that you read 1 Thessalonians all the way through from start to finish. And I said to you that when I'm preaching on 1 Thessalonians next time, I'll ask you how many of you have done that. So this is that moment. This is the teacher now checking up on your homework. So if since I spoke to you last, a few weeks ago, you've read 1 Thessalonians all the way through, can you put your hand up? That's not very impressive, class. You weren't here. You've got an extra week. Okay. I want to encourage you to do that because 1 Thessalonians is a letter. You know, when we read a letter, when someone writes to you, you know, you get a letter, you don't just read a paragraph and then sit and think about it for a week and then read another paragraph and sit and think about that for a week. You read the letter from front to back and then you go into the individual bits to understand them in more detail, don't you? Yes? Nod at me, say, yes, Pastor. So, we're doing the bit by bit here. Your homework is to sit and to read 1 Thessalonians all the way through. Won't take you very long, it's only a short letter. But I'd like you to do that before I come back to speak on 1 Thessalonians next time. So you've got, and I'll ask you again. So if you can make sure that you do that, you read it through, make yourself a nice cup of tea or coffee or whatever it is you want, and sit and read it through. It's been a few weeks since we looked at it last, so let's do a little bit of revision. We've already looked at most of the first two chapters, coming back in at verse 13 of chapter 2 this morning. What are the key things that we have learnt so far? What were the key things we learnt last time? And if there are things that you've learnt from earlier on that come back into your mind, you can say those. What are the key things that we've seen so far as we've gone through? It's been a few weeks. I appreciate that. But, yeah. Sophie.
We have been chosen by God.
We've been chosen by God, absolutely. Amen.
Yeah. We should be imitators of Christ.
We should be imitators of Christ, absolutely. We should be. The word Christian, remember, means little Christ. So we should be imitators of Christ. Yes, very good. What else? The things we looked at, particularly in the context of this period of outreach that we're doing, visiting these 2,000 homes. Yes, Sarah. We should preach the gospel. Can you remember anything about preaching the gospel? It's not just words, but power. It's not just words, but power. That's why when we're going out to tell people about Jesus, we're offering to pray for them. Because it isn't just the words of the gospel, it's the power of the gospel at work in people's lives. Very good. Anything else you remember? Yes.
God will not tempt us, but he will test our hearts. And we need to be pleasing God and not doing leaning on our own inclinations.
Yes, we need to be pleasing God. Do you remember I read this quote to you from Beale? Our only motive in doing anything as a Christian should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Our only motive for doing anything should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Anything else?
Be witnesses.
We should be witnesses, yes. Rangina.
We think of God as Father, but he has attributes of mother as well.
Yes, we looked at one of the verses that talks about God as being mother. So both motherhood and fatherhood find their true origin in God. So yes, it's father and mother. Okay, that's not bad, not bad. But when you read it through this week, you'll find other bits should come back to you. So we're starting today at chapter 2 and verse 13. And we also thank God continually. If you're still looking for it, it's page 1187. We also thank God continually because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but as it actually is the word of God, which is at work in you who believes. There's a really important principle in this verse. And the principle is this: how you receive the Bible, how you treat the Bible, determines its effect on you. If you look at the Bible, if someone reads the Bible and listens to the Bible and sees it as merely human words, it really is of little benefit. It's an interesting historical document, casts light on one or two things, but if you read it simply as human words, it has little effect on us. But if you take it for what it is, this book, as the word of God, it can powerfully be at work in you. Amen? So before we go on to these next few verses, as I've said that, are there examples that have come into your mind? This is like mini testimony, a mini short testimony, of times recently or maybe further ago, then God's word has been powerfully at work in you. When the word of God, the Bible, has been inside you and actually has been at work in your life. Can you think of any examples you'd want to share with us? Just short, just one a few examples of how God's word has been powerfully at work in you. Joe.
About a year ago, I was in quite a difficult situation at work. I was very fearful. I thought, oh, I'm going to get sacked because of my lack of confidence in that situation. And one morning in the car, I got a little book of, you know, Christian words, and it said, don't be afraid of sudden fear. It's a verse in Jeremiah, I think, or Isaiah. And I was like, oh, that seems quite pertinent, but I'm just going to kind of, it probably doesn't mean me. And then I felt God saying, well, actually, you've got to believe me and stop ignoring my word. So I was like, okay, I'm going to believe you, and I stopped being afraid.
Yeah, fantastic. So here's God's word, don't be afraid, at work in your life, and the fear goes. Fantastic. Amen. Two more. Mark.
God's word moved in my life. I remember when John Paul first came down from Liverpool, and we were struggling with a lot of bad situations. We had to find housing, and I kept saying to John Paul that trusting God, all things we can achieve through God. And at first, John Paul didn't have a relationship with God, but now he's developed one. And we've had so many blessings. And
okay,
John Paul...
so here's this God's word at work in you, that he can do all things as we believe. And you see that become a reality. Fantastic. Thank you. Ismat.
Yeah, it's something not recently happened, every time happened. When we pray, it is not a monologue, it is a dialogue. So we give space to God to talk to us through his word and to listen to him so he can direct us.
Okay, thank you very much. Lastly, I know I said two, but we'll go for one more. Wendy.
Before I started my degree, I wanted guidance and whether it's a thing to do. And then it was reading Daniel about Daniel and the others being trained for nourishment and training and then learning all different kinds of learning and understanding.
Fantastic.
Okay, pretty clear.
Wendy is doing a degree in nutrition, and there was this word from God. That from Daniel about these people being trained in diet and all of that sort of stuff, and just God's word. I see one more. I'm gonna. All right, we'll go with it. Go on.
I'm studying. My studies have been challenged my faith so much. Sometimes I'm crying, saying, God, I don't know this God they are talking about, but the word of God is so powerful in my heart that I just said, God, you know what? I just choose to love you and believe in your word. But I just want to ask you, God, and more, he's just powerful in my life. Because, you know, I know my study's going to, I think, for the second level, it's going to be hard.
Okay.
And but the word of God has to be in us. Because
so as God's word is in you, it yes. overcomes unbelief.
Yes.
It overcomes all that other stuff that comes our way. Fantastic. So you see, God's word powerfully at work in us as we receive it as God's word. In the members' meeting this afternoon, we're going to be presenting, we're not going through in detail, but we're going to be presenting some of our strategic objectives. And one of those, you will have had this document last week, it's at the back if you've not got it yet. And one of our strategic objectives is to see every church member regularly meeting with others specifically for sharing, prayer and reading the Bible. Another of our objectives is to see personal prayer, Bible study, not just Bible reading, but Bible study and listening to God as a priority for every church member. We want to see God's word inside people because it's transformative. It changes people's lives. It gives you what you need for the situations that you face. And how you take it and how you take it in determines its effect in you. So receive it as God's word and allow it to work in you, to change you and to transform you and to sustain you. Some people use the phrase about God's word being like daily bread. It's the stuff we need to keep us going through each day. It's nourishment from God. So take hold of it. Amen? Verses 14 to 16. These are very difficult verses, and they're very controversial verses. I'm going to read them to you in a moment. These verses are so controversial that a lot of Bible commentators actually say Paul could not have written these verses. There is no evidence whatsoever that he didn't write these verses, but people can't cope with them. So they're saying, it obviously isn't Paul. If it wasn't Paul, it's not God, so we can ignore them. In some of the lectionaries used in some of the big denominational churches, they actually miss these verses out. They read up to verse 13, and then they jump over to verse 17. They don't read verses 14 to 16, because they're considered to be too difficult. But as far as I'm concerned, if it's part of God's word, it's there for us to understand. Amen? So, I'm going to read them to you, and then we're going to do some work. I'm going to take you through and help you understand these verses. For you, brothers, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. You suffered from your own countrymen the same things those churches suffered from the Jews, who killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets, and also drove us out. They displease God and are hostile to all men in their effort to keep us from speaking to the Gentiles, so that they may be saved. In this way, they always heap up their sins to the limit. The wrath of God has come upon them at last. The interpretation of these verses has had a very, very sorry history. I'm very sorry to have to admit that these verses have been understood in inverted commas, have been abused better by people calling themselves Christians to justify the pogroms against the Jews in the Middle Ages. And these were verses that were used by so-called Christians to justify the Holocaust, the massacre of Jews that took place in the Second World War. These are the verses that they claimed justified those atrocities. They do not in any sense justify them. But we need to understand what it is that Paul is saying here and what it is that God is saying to us. So we need to work through Paul's argument here. The context of Paul writing was firstly that the churches in Judea, he's writing to Thessalonica, but the churches in Judea, the area, sort of geographical area around Jerusalem, were being persecuted by the Jews. And you may remember that Paul was a part of that persecution process himself. Do you remember, before he became a Christian, he was on the road, he was on his way to persecute some more Christians. And he was doing that, in his own testimony, because he was zealous as a Jew. So that was, it's a historical fact, that in that period of time, the Jews were opposing and oppressing the churches that were there in Judea. The Thessalonians were also being persecuted. Their persecution was not by the Jews, but by their fellow countrymen who did not like the fact that they were becoming Christians. So what Paul is doing in this passage is saying to the Thessalonians, look, what is happening to you is not really that strange. Look where the church started. It started in Judea, and there the churches were persecuted. There the people suffered. And so what's happening to you is just a part of the bigger picture. It's nothing special. We're going to come back to that when we get into chapter 3 a little bit later this morning. It's nothing special what's happening. It's just ordinary. It's just a part of how things are. And as a part of explaining that, he does some explaining about the situation of the Jews. Firstly, he goes back to the Old Testament. And it's there, it's clear, it's historical. In the Old Testament, there are accounts of the Jewish people killing some of the prophets that came to them, sent by God. And it's clear in the Old Testament, the nation of Israel, the Jewish people, were judged by God because they killed the prophets that he sent to them, God's mouthpieces that he sent. And so finally, as it says elsewhere in the New Testament, God sent his own son to the Jewish nation, came to his own people. Jesus, of course, was a Jew, as was Paul, was born as a Jew, lived as a Jew, and he was rejected by his own people. They rejected him, and they weren't allowed to kill him, but they had him killed by the Romans. The third fact, again, undisputed, is that subsequently the Jews tried to do all they could do to hinder the spread of the gospel, to stop people becoming Christians, to stop Jews becoming Christians, and to stop Gentiles becoming Christians. They believed that this was a heretical sect, and who falsely, the Jews believed, were claiming that the Messiah had come. And so they were doing all they could to stop the gospel being spread. And the final result of this is that God has judged them. The wrath of God has come upon them at last, as it says in verse 16. Now it's likely that that has a twofold reference. I'm not going to go into explain the reasons for why I believe that, but you can ask me afterwards if you want to, but it's a twofold reference. It's referring, on the one hand, to a specific historical event. It's likely to be referring to an event that happened in 49 AD, just before this letter was written. An event that happened in Jerusalem. There was some political turmoil, and there was a rebellion, quite a large rebellion, by a group of Jews against the Romans, who were the occupying power. The Romans' response to that, as always when there was rebellion, is just to slaughter everybody that they could lay their swords on. And so there was a wholesale slaughtering of Jews in Jerusalem in AD 49. Again, it's a historical fact. And it's possible that that is what Paul is referring to here as the historical part. But the other thing which he unpacks elsewhere, we've seen it previously, is that because God's chosen people rejected first of all God, then rejected his spokespeople, the prophets, and then rejected his son Jesus, God rejected them as his chosen people and replaced them with a new chosen people. The New Testament calls it the new Israel of God. We know it better as the church, you and me. We are now God's chosen people. We've looked at that in Peter. Do you remember that there? God's chosen people, our holy nation. It's about us as church. So the final part of that judgment is that the Jews have been replaced as God's chosen people with us. And elsewhere in Romans, Paul just reminds people like us that actually if God's original chosen people can be replaced, if they are faithless, God will replace you lot if you're faithless. So it is a reminder of God's judgment. But we need to remember something very important here, that this new Israel, this church, is made up not exclusively of non-Jews. It's made up of Jews who believe in Jesus and non-Jews who believe in Jesus. And in fact, in the church membership here, we have at least one Jew who is one of our church members. So it is not a rejection of Jews as people, but it is a statement that they are no longer God's chosen people. And in no way, under any God-given interpretation of these verses, does it justify for one moment anti-Semitism, attacks on Jews, hostility to Jewish people at all. Doesn't say that, and you have to abuse the text to interpret it in that way. God loves Jews as much as he loves Gentiles, and he wants all of us to come to Jesus on the same basis and become part of the new Israel, the new chosen people, the new people of God. If you're going to come back, I'm not going to spend time discussing it with you because it is a difficult and complex passage. If you've got questions that emerge from that for you as you think about it, have a listen to this again when it's on the website later this week. And you've still got questions, send me an email, phone me, ask me, and I'm very happy to go through any of the individual bits in detail. I've gone over it somewhat at a surface level because this is actually a very complex passage here. And I've just taken the main statements of it there, that you can get hold of that. But it's important that we don't ignore verses that people misinterpret. It really is important that we remember that this is all God's word. And we take it and we understand it. We allow God's spirit to apply it to us. And it actually is for us, it's fantastic good news. Because we are now God's chosen people. Amen? Amen. We are the new Israel. We are the inheritors of the promises in the Old Testament made to God's people there. We are now the inheritors because they chose to reject, sadly. And so we are welcomed in and we receive the benefit of all those promises. Oh, isn't that fantastic? Amen. Amen. Let's move on to a slightly easier territory. Verse 17. But brothers, when we were torn away from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you again. Sorry, we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did, again and again. But Satan stopped us. For what is our hope? Our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes, is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. Torn away is a really strong phrase. It implies a forceful, an unnatural, a painful separation. Paul just separated. He'd led these people to Jesus, seen them just become Christians, a church established, and he is then wrenched away, torn away, forcefully, unnaturally, and painfully, and he's not able to come back and see how they're doing because Satan stopped us. Now, there's been a huge amount of speculation as to what that means. The answer is, we don't know. I can give you 20 or 30 different theories, but the answer is we actually don't know what that referred to. Just that he was not able to go because Satan stopped us. But it does remind us of something very important. The reality of spiritual opposition and spiritual warfare. It reminds us that we're in a battle. It's why in this outreach that we are in the middle of at the moment, we've bathed the whole thing in prayer. Prayer beforehand, prayer during. Why we've got this prayer meetings every evening, or Monday to Thursday evenings next week. Because we recognize that we are in a battle. We recognize that this is not without enemies. Satan is out to oppose and to stop. And spiritual warfare is not a pushover. Sometimes when you hear people talk or you hear people pray in this whole area of spiritual warfare, you would think that it's just as simple as a few phrases that you state and you claim it and it's done and dusted and sorted. Sometimes it is. But sometimes it's not. It's not as straightforward as that. Here is the man in the New Testament, head and shoulders above everyone else other than Jesus in the New Testament. The apostle above all other apostles. Man of faith. Saw people raised from the dead. Saw miracles happen of healing, of deliverance. Planted churches all over the place. God at work in him and through him in all sorts of contexts. If anyone had a vibrant, faith-filled prayer life, it was Paul. If anyone understood the reality of spiritual warfare, it was Paul. But in this context, and this isn't the only place, he's prevented from doing what God wanted him to do. He says, Satan stopped us. And it reminds us of the reality of spiritual opposition. We need to stay rooted and deep in God. Paul didn't lose faith. Paul didn't give up. Probably didn't fully understand all that was happening. But he stayed in God. But it reminds us of that. But what I want to pull out for you in this passage that's most important is this. Paul, he's in a different, difficult context here. He's been removed from where he wanted to be, painfully, unnaturally, forcefully. He's detained in another place where he doesn't want to be. And what is it that fills his thoughts? Is it the sadness at the separation? Is it the fact that he is distressed that he can't get back? Is it because he's perplexed and bewildered why Satan has been able to stop him? None of that at all. What is filling his horizon? It's Jesus coming back. It's Jesus coming back. And his hope and his joy in the crown in which he will glory in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes. The whole expectation of Jesus' return framed Paul's life. All the time it was there. And for us, it should be the same. Here's a quote from a guy called Wanamaker. I assume that's how his name is pronounced. It's how it's written, so apologies to him if I'm violating how his name ought to be pronounced. The joy of the early Christians was based on their certainty of future salvation, regardless of what happened to them in the present. The joy of the early Christians was based on the certainty of future salvation, regardless of what happened to them in the present. So here he is, we see him, a snapshot of him here, in a really difficult situation. He's in emotional pain, in turmoil, he's struggling. What's filling his horizon? Is it his problems? No. Is it the pain? No. Is it the difficulty? No. Is it his frustration? No. What's filling his horizon? Jesus is coming back, and I'm going to be with him. Amen. So for us, when we from time to time face difficulties, which we will, we're going to come on to it in chapter 3, it's a normal part of the Christian life. When we face those things, what should be filling our horizon? Jesus. Not the problems, not the difficulties, not the distress. Jesus. And our hope in Jesus. And our joy doesn't come out of the problems we're facing. Our joy comes from the certainty of our future salvation that's begun now in us, regardless of what is going on in the present. And we're going to come back to this in a lot more detail when we get towards the end of 1 Thessalonians and look in a lot more detail at Jesus' second coming, his return there. Notice also something else here, that Paul is expecting that he is going to be judged by God. And he's going to be judged on the basis of what he's done with what God has given him. He's confident. He goes into more detail of this in some of the other letters. But he is confident. He has been faithfully serving God with what God has given him, whatever that God's put in his hands. So he's looking forward to meeting Jesus. I wonder how it is with you. For you who are Christians, for you who are believers, you who have already made that decision to commit your life to God, you will stand before Jesus one day. And he will look at what you've done with your life. I wonder if that day was Sunday, the 5th of April, 2009. About half past 12, 5 minutes' time. I wonder how you would be feeling. Whether you would be anticipating that with excitement. I'm going to be Jesus. I'm going to meet Jesus. And I've done with all the things he gave me what he's wanted me to do. And I'm really excited. I'm going to get this reward from him for faithfully serving him. Or I wonder if you're thinking, 5 minutes. I haven't got time to sort out all the things that he asked me to do that I've not done. There's so many things that I've done that I shouldn't have done that I haven't sorted out. I better start repenting, asking for forgiveness of sins, and I better pray really fast for the next 5 minutes. I wonder how it is with you. So here's the question for those of you who are hearing the teaching for the first time. From time to time as I go through, I ask questions just to help us reflect on things. So, assuming that he's not coming back in 4 minutes' time, how should the reality of Jesus' return and the fact that we will have to give an account before him of how we've lived our lives, how should it affect us in this next week, month, year? How should it be affecting our lives? How should it be affecting your life? Is that hand scratching or about to speak? Look at terror. You were just scratching. You shouldn't, it's like being at an auction, you know. You shouldn't just stretch when I've asked a question. Belinda.
As the words of the song we sang, one of the songs we sang this morning, saying, every day, we should live for Jesus. You are live for.
every day it's you I live for. Belinda, you're a school teacher. What does it mean for you? You at school tomorrow? Have you broken up yet?
Oh, Easter holidays.
Easter holidays. When you go back to school after you've had another long and well-deserved holiday, did I get that right? When you go back, how does the fact that you every day live for Jesus, how does that affect how you do your job?
It pleases my heart, and I hope it pleases God as well, because I'm trying very hard to do what he wants me to do. And I know whatever time he comes, I'll be ready.
Okay.
So hoping that I'm doing the right thing.
So in your job, you're seeking to serve him all the time.
All the time.
It's in your mind. Very good. What else? But it's very clear in a number of places in the New Testament, which this is one, that actually God looks at what we've done with the stuff. The parable of the talents is a great example of that. You know, God has put talents in our heart, you know, in our hands. And the story there at the end of that, the question is, what have you done with the talents I've given you? It's a really important principle that's there. Yes?
Sharing Jesus with others, like telling them what, sharing what we have.
Yeah, because we're so looking forward to meeting. We want all our friends and neighbours, our work colleagues, we want them to be meeting him as well, don't we? So we want to tell people about Jesus. Yeah, very good. Fiona?
Yes, I personally need to be a bit more disciplined in my Bible reading than I am, because it's something I can't like rest notes, so it's turning off TV a bit more and also going out there a bit more and being prepared to do the encounters that God wants me to have.
Okay, less TV, more Bible reading.
And more encounters.
And more encounters with people, telling them about Jesus. And
when
just
it's right, or just
yeah,
being
and just being with them. Yeah, very good. Steve?
It's been said already, but it's the whole thing of, you know, this is for everyone, and we need to be warning people that, you know, everyone's going to go through this. So
yeah, we need to be telling people about Jesus. Mark?
Also, living our life with Jesus and telling other people, reaching out, but not doing it because we want reward. Because that's tantamount to having a friend asking you to go to the shop and get me a Mars bar.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're a friend, you go and do it. But if you're a friend, then you say, I'll go and get a Mars bar, but if I get a bite of it, then that's not really a true friend. You do it because you love God.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. We do it because we love God. But part of that is recognizing that with the gifts that God gives us come responsibilities to use those things as he has given, as he's blessed us with them to use those. Joe. Sorry, I didn't see you when I walked past.
I just think I would like to know Jesus better myself, because, you know, he's the most important thing God gave us, and he's going to come back and we're going to meet him. So if I know him now, I can start to enjoy the heaven I'll experience when I see him.
Mm. That's really good. Getting to know him more and more in the now as well. Oh, amen. Let's go into chapter 3 and the first 5 verses. So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and God's fellow worker, in spreading the gospel of Christ to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. You know quite well that we were destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted. And it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter might have tempted you and our efforts might have been useless. There is an amazing description here of Timothy. Find it there in verse 2. God's fellow worker. God's fellow worker. It's an amazing description of the way that God chooses to work with us. You know, in some companies, the way they're structured, you know, you've got your boss, your management sort of out there somewhere in the remote thing, and sort of the minions who are just getting on and doing the job. And there is this huge gap between the people that are doing the job and the people that are managing and running the show. You understand what I mean? There are other companies that operate in a very different way, where everyone, whatever level they are in the company, they have a share of the company. And actually they are all seen as working together. They're co-working together in the enterprise of making this company successful. And it's a very different place to work, isn't it? Some of you are in places like that, or in places like the other. And it's a very, very different place to work. In God's kingdom, we are all co-workers with God. Isn't that amazing? God who created and sustains the whole of the universe, he looks at you, co-worker, working alongside him. He chooses to work with us and through us and alongside us. As over this period of time, we've been sharing the good news. We're partway through in this Easter period with people in our local area, 2,000 homes, 6,000 people perhaps, either through speaking to or through leaflets, others that we're going to see in our events, or we have seen already, or we're going to see in our events over this period. We are in doing this with God's fellow workers. We're working with him. We don't go out without him, do we? You heard it in the testimonies this morning. God's Spirit in us, with us, giving us the words, giving us the confidence, giving us the boldness to do that. Amen. So who likes being a fellow worker with God? Amen. Amen. But in our life, even as fellow workers with God, from time to time, things are difficult. Trials, difficulties are a normal part of the Christian life. These things that come our way, they are a normal part of the Christian life. And when something difficult happens to us, it is not an indication that God has left us. It's not an indication that we lack faith. I've got this amazing quote. Listen to this. A guy called Beale, he wrote this. The only pathway to the eternal kingdom is one lined with trials through which believers must steadfastly pass in order to enter in. The only pathway to the eternal kingdom is one lined with trials through which believers must steadfastly pass in order to finally enter in. It's a part of our experience. And sometimes we can forget that. You know, when something hard comes our way, I was talking to someone recently who's having a really tough time in their context at this period in time. And the tendency that happens is that tough time just fills our horizon. We just end up thinking all the time about the difficulties, about the problems, about who said what, and how we're going to deal with this, and what's going to happen next, and it just fills the horizon. When we do that, we are actually moving out of God's best for us. We need to continue to allow our minds, our horizon, to be filled by Jesus. And recognize that these are normal things that happen on the route. And the amazing thing is that God always, how often?
Always.
Uses those things for our good. Always. Not sometimes. Not now and then when he remembers. Always, when difficulties come our way, God has a redemptive strategy, a way of using those things for the good for those that love him. All things work to the good for those who love Jesus. So, final question, before I come to the final question, if you see what I mean. Final question in this teaching part. For us now, as we, again, this week, this month, difficulties will come our way. We've already had some testimonies this morning that mentioned difficulties. Some of the things have been shared in here. How do we allow God to transform those difficulties into opportunities? How does that happen for us? How do we do that? Steve, have you got... You going to speak?
No, I wouldn't. I was a special head.
Get on with it.
Say something, though. So what was the question again?
The question is, Steve, yes. When we face difficulties...
Yeah.
Now, I know with... Let's just... You know, I know with your business.
Yeah.
You know, last year you faced some challenges.
Yeah.
Economic turmoil and difficulties. Now, how in those difficulties... Because I remember we prayed sometimes when things were looking a little bit desperate... Mm-hmm. In those situations, how did you allow God to turn that around for you? What did you do?
I think the most important thing is, in anything in life, and this being one of them,
is listening to what God's got to say about what you're going through. And in listening to him, there is hope, there is direction, and there is peace. And as long as you follow what he says in that situation and obedient to that, I mean, he may say to me, give it up, but there is a reason why you need to give it up. Or it may be, okay, you've got to go through this, but I'm holding your hand through it. But if you allow him to go be the centre of what you're going through, he can make a mountain look like a flat bit of ground.
Okay. And you have seen, haven't you? Because we're on the other side of that now.
Yeah.
You have seen some amazing answers to prayer.
We have done.
And we're
continuing to pray. I mean, you don't stop praying, you continue to pray and listen to God.
Yeah, fantastic. Fiona?
It's also time when you need to share, perhaps when you're kind of like feeling at your worst and you're anxious. Mm-hmm. And it's really difficult to open up and go to somebody in the church and say, actually, I'm going through a tough time because it's supposed to be upbeat and that, or the impression is it's always supposed to be upbeat here. It's the time when you need to go and say, hey, I'm struggling. It's time to go down the front and not be, you know, nobody watches you when you're down the front. It is a private moment. It's between you and God. It's between.
So it's allowing God to minister to us through other people, isn't it? And just and
share.
Very important. Okay, Liz.
It's also what those people have said, but also for your own relationship with God, sometimes when troubles come, as you say, they fill the horizon and we can't see God for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we shut down and we try the human way of finding a way out. And if we don't, first port of call has to be God, and that's not always easy. And it's that going to God and telling him how you're feeling is essential.
Okay.
You can't do it in your own strength.
Thank you. Wasima?
I think the focal point altogether is God. Whatever comes in, sit down, pray, talk to God for direction, seeking otherwise. Options, everything, and listen.
Okay, so it's about allowing God to fill the horizon again, isn't it? It's creating that space. Yeah, finally. Just both of you. So
finding that deep peace within, because there are times when it's gone. And once you can find a peace within, then you can begin to come in.
Okay, and that peace comes from God's spirit in us, doesn't it? Thank you very much.
I think it's basically pray when you feel like praying, pray when you don't feel like praying.
Uh-huh. So even when you don't feel like talking to God about it, you need to be talking to God. You need to be praying about that. Okay, thank you very much. So what are the key things we take away from this morning? What are the key lessons that we've learned this morning that we take away into this week? What are the key things?
Times, but to acknowledge that God wants us to have some bad times.
Okay, so just to acknowledge that bad times are just a part of how life is.
Don't feel too angry about it.
Yeah, don't get angry with God, but allow God to transform it.
You can't get angry with God because that's fine.
Well, what I meant was we sometimes can get so angry with God that we're not talking to him.
Yeah.
That's what, you know, yes, it is okay to express.
Not personal, it's what he does to all of us.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much. Yeah.
We're co-workers with God.
We're co-workers with God. Amen. Timmy.
Our focus should always be on Christ.
Our focus should always be on Christ, whatever is happening, even armed robbers. Our focus should always be on Christ, yeah.
Yeah, that the pathway to know God is full of... the path to knowing God is rough and full of obstacles.
Yeah. Path to knowing God, it's rough, it's full of obstacles. Thank you very much indeed. Three things for me as I look back over this morning. This statement, I mean, it's a huge theological statement that the church has replaced the Jews as God's people. Our expectation of Jesus' return should affect how we live now. More of that later in Thessalonians. But that's a key thing, that should be in our horizon, the reality that Jesus is coming back. And that trials and difficulties are a normal part of the Christian life, and God uses them for our eternal good. Let's stand together. I'm going to give you a moment to make a quiet response to God, maybe something you want to say to him. And then in a moment or two, I'm going to pray for us as we come to the end of this part of our time together. So a few moments of quiet, first of all. Father God, I thank you for the fact that we are your people. We are chosen by you. We're part of your family. As we come from so many different nationalities, cultures, ages, different intellectual abilities, different gifts, whole mix of people, but together we are your chosen people. Here, just a teeny amount of those in our world, but that you have chosen us and brought us into your family. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the amazing thing that you have made us your co-workers, that we work alongside you, we work with you, you work through us. Father God, thank you for that amazing thing that you choose to use us, that you give us gifts, you place your spirit inside us. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you take us through all the difficulties that we face in life. Father, I want to pray specifically at this moment for anybody who is here this morning, who is watching this subsequently, who is facing a major difficulty in their life. Father, I want to ask for you to presence yourself with them powerfully, and for you to fill their horizon, for you, the living God, to fill their horizon from side to side, for the difficulty to be turfed out, for the fear to be gone and replaced by your love and your peace, the reality of your presence and their hope of eternal salvation in you and your joy to fill them. I want to pray for that. Claim it for people who are here now and people who are watching this subsequently. And Father God, as we as a church family continue this week to reach out systematically into our local community, I want to ask you will help us to hold on to the fact that we are your co-workers, to allow your spirit to work in us and through us. Father, I want to ask for a corporate, fresh anointing of your spirit upon us as your church family here. In whatever we do, whoever we talk with, in this Easter season, we will have the opportunity for being and telling good news about Jesus' death, resurrection, and your love for all people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.